Hello everyone, and welcome to this Moodle Academy webinar on facilitating Moodle forums. Very pleased to welcome you today. So I am Mary Cooch, Education Manager at Moodle Academy. It may say Academy on the webinar, but I am in fact Mary Cooch, I'm not the whole Academy. I will be doing the presenting here, and I have alongside me Anna Krasser, who's going to be monitoring the chat. Would you like to say hello, Anna?
Hello, everyone. Nice to be here today. I hope you will enjoy our session.
Okay. So let's get started. We do want this to be an interactive session, so it's not just going to be me talking and then Anna replying. At intervals, we're going to ask for your experiences and your opinions. And I always like to begin by saying not only what we will be discussing, but what we are not going to be discussing. And it's important to realize that this webinar is at an intermediate level. It's for people who are experienced using Moodle. So we're not going to be showing you the technical side of how to set up a forum, enabling editing and so on. We have our Moodle Teaching Basics program for that. So we're going to look at it not from a technical setting up point of view, but more from a pedagogical point of view. So we are going to be discussing how to, and I'm reading from the slide here, initiate, promote, encourage, optimize, monitor, moderate, facilitate, basically make the most of a forum. And you know, the title is facilitating Moodle forums. In fact, facilitate, which is the word that I've put in bold on the slide there, facilitating and moderating are two terms related to forums that are sometimes used interchangeably. I know I do it myself. If we want to be pedantic, there is actually a difference, although in our webinar, we're going to be discussing all of them. So just to be precise, out of interest, so a forum moderator, when we're talking about Moodle forums, this is actually an actual role, usually the editing teacher, but doesn't have to be, but it's a role that has permissions. A forum moderator can edit other people's posts after the time. They can split them if they're going off topic. They can delete posts if they're inappropriate. And they can also send private replies to people who post that are not visible to others. So a forum moderator is a little bit like a police officer, if you like, in the forums. Whereas a forum facilitator, now, they can be the same person, and they often are, but they don't necessarily. And a forum facilitator is more of a nurturing or an encouraging role. So their role is to engage and encourage the participants in the forums, and also to ensure that they stay on topic and that they don't say anything inappropriate. And all of these are things we will be covering in today's webinar. So let's get started. We have chosen to use a forum in our Moodle course. And the first thing we'd like to look at is why. What is the benefits of a forum over other activities? And we're going to briefly look at the different types of forum, not, as I said, in terms of setting them up, but what are their advantages and why you might be interested in them. And then we're going to also ask for your opinions too. So from my point of view, the best reason for using a forum is that it's asynchronous. In other words, it gives you time to think. It's not like a live webinar or a live chat or a big blue button activity where you have to respond immediately when people ask you a question. You can read it at your leisure, take time to reflect on your response, and then reply. And forums also work very well in terms of inclusion. So universal design for learning suggests that we should give people different ways to respond. And in a forum, as we'll see, you can type your answer, you can record your voice. If you're brave enough, you can even use a video. Moodle, social constructionism, and a lot of Moodle works around that. It's the basis of that. And certainly discussing things in a forum is part of that community building. You can add a search forums block and you can easily search through forums. And also one thing that I like, that's not the usual use of forum, but it does help with basic sharing of activities. If you want your participants to share a file they've done, a document they've done, they can simply attach it in a forum. And you can also use it for easy peer review. The workshop activity is the best activity for peer assessment, if you like, but you can also do it at a lesser, simpler level using a forum. And not only peer review, but peer support. So if you have a forum where people are asking questions, it doesn't have to be you, the teacher, answering. Obviously, the learners can answer each other and support each other. But alongside that, we have the announcements forum, which is a forum, but it's not quite, isn't it? Because it is for the teachers to post notices and it's not really for discussion or replying. But if you need that teacher-led element, you also have the announcements forum. So we definitely want to use a forum. Which type will meet our need? If you don't do anything, you will get the standard forum for general use, which allows anyone to add a new discussion and reply to other discussions. But it's worth exploring the other types because they might meet different needs. When I was a high school teacher, which I was for 28 years, and we started using Moodle in 2006, I used to often use a simple single discussion because basically it keeps the learners focused on one topic. They can't start another discussion on something else. They can only reply to what the teacher began. Now, my favorite type is each person posts one discussion because this works very well for the sharing or the peer review and so on. You each have your own discussion topic, which you own, if you like, in the forum. Q&A forum is also very useful. I have an idea. Anna likes this one in particular. I'll ask her in a moment, where a learner cannot see the responses of others until they've made their own contribution. Standard forum displayed in a blog-like format gives you a little summary of what's coming up. And then I've separated it because you don't really reply or discuss in it, but announcements is very useful. So these are the forum types, and we've explored why we might want to use a forum. I'm actually going to now pass it over to you. Please, would you like to type in the chat? Which are your favorite types of forums or which ones do you not like? Why? And I'm also going to ask Anna if she'd like to comment on what she thinks about the different types of forums and the benefits of forums.
Well, yes, as you said already, Mary, my favorite one is, I think, the QA. Okay, I might use the standard forum, I think, like everybody, mostly, but my most favorite is the Q&A because I have my experiences from corporate environment where the collaboration and the communication between people was very highly appreciated, yet people wanted also the original ideas, the original solutions in some case studies. And so the Q&A was the perfect tool because participants had to share their original thoughts and then had also the chance to collaborate and communicate with each other. Meanwhile, I can see we have some messages in the chat. So Jan says that I have explored the different types, but usually goes for the standard one. Brenda also mostly for the standard with some QA where appropriate. Yes. Actually, I like turning on also the grading, the rating in QA. So Salome says, replying to, I have explored the so I guess replying to it's like a single simple question.
Single simple discussion.
discussion, yes. And Brenda says ratings are very useful in forums. And I think that's all the comments we have so far.
Okay, so, now ratings is interesting because we will be talking about that later on, actually, Anna.
Oh, John says that she has never used the ratings. Now that's something very interesting to see.
Yeah, and also grading as well, although we're not going to go into detail on that, but not only can you rate forums, you can also grade them. So let's move on then. So we've decided in our course we're going to use a forum. We've possibly decided the type of forum we want. But before we do anything, we really need to consider a code of conduct, because even if we have mature adults, it may well happen that something is said inappropriately or there's some unsatisfactory behavior in our forums. So I'd like us to think, presumably on your site, I'd like to believe that you have a general code of conduct for participants who are engaging online. Does this include forums? Do you have a forum code of conduct just for your course? Do you, if you do, actually agree this with your learners in advance of the course? I've had experience of courses like that online. Or is it something that either you, the teacher, or your organization hierarchy impose on them, the kinds of information? So the content. Now, I could give you a couple of examples before we ask your views. So, for example, the two sites where I am most active, Moodle.org, this is our global site where we have over 30 courses, which we call communities, full of forums. And obviously in many different languages, many different types of people. So in our site policy, we have the forums code of conduct. And you can see this if you go to Moodle in English, it's right at the top in the hope that people will read it. It's quite wordy. I'll just show you some of it. I'm not going to read it all to you. But this is a special case on Moodle.org because we have many questions and answers, people coming to help ask for help solving their problems. So, for example, we ask you, I'm reading from the slide here, choose an informative subject line. So it's very difficult if someone with a problem comes and says, help, or urgent, because that doesn't tell us what they want. And maybe if we're in a hurry and there are lots of posts, we're going to ignore it. The same could also apply in your own course. It's not particularly useful if you just have a one-word non-descriptive subject title. Something else also is to try and present facts and background in your post rather than just saying, I can't get this to work, this is terrible, which does sometimes happen. So that's specific to Moodle.org. We also, on Moodle Academy, we have general discussion forums in each of the courses. They're not monitored, but we do encourage people who join the courses perhaps to support each other, as mentioned earlier on. And we have a code of conduct here. And one of the things we ask is, for example, only post meaningful and relevant content. And every now and then, we might get people who will come and post in a course. Our courses are self-paced, and they will post hi as a subject title and hi in the description, which is not unkind. It's just it's not particularly helpful. And if we get a lot of those, they can clutter up the course page. One thing that I will add before I move on to ask you for your thoughts on this is when I did a master's on Moodle, one of the things we were asked to do was to make sure that we typed our forum contributions in correct grammar rather than using text speak or WhatsApp messaging abbreviations. That was partly because our forum posts formed part of the assessment, but that's something else you might have in your code of conduct. So first of all, I'd just like you to give me a quick yes or no. In your organization, do you agree on a code of conduct with your course participants? Type yes. Or if no, because maybe this is a code of conduct that you've decided or your organization has decided, or maybe you don't even have one, then say no. So I'd like to know how many yeses, how many noes, and I'll ask Anna to monitor that. And then as people are typing, whether yes, we agree with our course participants on a code of conduct, or no, we don't. I'd also like to ask Anna and also you, if you'd like to make your comments, do you use a code of conduct?
Usually in corporate environments, there is a wider policy and a corporate code of conduct on how we communicate, how we do things, and how the behavior is. But I have a very interesting experience to share, which is not from a corporate environment, but it's from my primary school. And that was amazing. It was a collaboration between two schools that were in a distance, and they were collaborating on specific courses, and they built together their code of conduct. And I found this absolutely amazing, because it teachers help learners, students, young students, to actually collaborate and be ethical. They were nurturing this idea of code of conduct and of the right way of communicating. From the chat, let me just go quickly. We have like five yeses and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 5 no's.
Okay.
The audience is half and half.
Okay.
I don't know if someone would like to share a specific case where you use a code of conduct or no.
Or if there's anything in yours that you think might be of interest or helpful to other people, for example, like, do you insist on correct grammar and no abbreviations and so on? Or that's just my particular example.
Well, in our in my experience, both in the primary school and the business environment, the answer is no, because the business, the corporate academy was international, so language was not considered to be the main point of the work.
Yeah,
it was just the medium. And also in primary school, that could be considered, but because they didn't want to dehearten young learners and their focus was based on something else, they didn't pay attention to that. Now, I see Carla is saying that in my case, I'm executive director at NGO, and we set up previous agreements of what we commit to and what we expect from participants. That's good.
Yeah.
And John says, our participants speak a variety of languages, so we don't expect perfect spelling or grammar in English. Yes, that's common case. Brenda says that ours is informal. The four PAs agreed on before we start the course. We discuss preparedness, punctuality, presence, and participation with a group of adults. That's really interesting.
Okay, thank you. Oh, go on,
okay.
Carry on.
Another message from Usman. As a drug posology seat, better it's short, better it is. However, the shortness is a handicap, namely with big group in academic level. We try just to rely on self-responsibility. I can understand this, that... yes, a long series of guidelines are not very appreciated usually by learners.
Yes,
often they are just bypassed.
Yeah, absolutely. And incidentally, on Moodle.org, we don't have any kind of rules about how you should write your messages, because we have many people whose first language isn't English, and it's just communicating that is the most important. And I want to say, I often see on Moodle.org people posting forum posts, and the first thing they say is, I'm sorry about my English. And I will always go in and say, No, do not apologize. You are better than many other people that you speak more than one language. It's absolutely fine. So never apologize for speaking a foreign language. Okay, shall we move on?
Yes, yes.
Now, we've got our code of conduct. We've set up our forum. We're actually starting a new course, perhaps with some new learners or a new module. I'd like to briefly think about this concept of icebreakers. And I have to smile because for the first time in my life, about 2 weeks ago, I visited a real actual icebreaker in the literal sense. I was in St. Petersburg and it was a museum on a ship icebreaker. But what we normally mean, as we do now, an icebreaker and breaking the ice is when you have an activity to make people feel more comfortable who haven't yet met before. So you might have these activities in a face-to-face course meeting or online, just so that people can get to know each other. And I was wondering how you feel about using icebreakers like this in your forums, whether they should be obligatory or not, and the kinds of activities you might do. I can give you two examples. One that we've always liked, when we used to have a Learn Moodle MOOC twice a year, we ran a global MOOC to help people get to learn how to teach with Moodle. And when we did one online in the pandemic, we realized that no one could actually leave their house. And so as our icebreaker, we asked people to post pictures of what they could see from their window, which was a very good way of promoting discussions and getting to know people. And different people around the world posted different weather. We had snow, we had sunshine, we had a lot of pets and so on. If people weren't in a didn't have a window because they were in a basement, they would post a picture of a picture that was on their wall or a notice board, for example. That's just one nice icebreaker. Another one that I've used, and in fact, I was a guest speaker in a teacher training session in Sri Lanka last week, and for their icebreaker, they were using the Two Truths and a Lie, which is a very simple activity in a forum where each person says three statements, two of which are true, one of which isn't, and then you wait a short while and people try to guess which one might be true, which one might be the lie. And then after a certain period of time, you can give your response. It's always useful if you as the teacher give an example as well. So just two examples. I'd like to ask you then, I was going to say as well that if you're going to do this, again, because of the way forums are set up, you don't have to type your answer. So here we've got student Mark, and this is an example, it's not a real one, who has decided he will video his Two Truths and a Lie. You can also, from the editor, you can press the microphone and you can record your voice, but not show your face. So you have different options to present what you want to say in the forum. But should an icebreaker be obligatory or not? Do you use icebreakers? What kind of activities do you use? I'm going to pass it over to Anna and then to you in the chat.
Well, while people is typing at home, my experience, well, it's not exactly obligatory, but an icebreaker won't be a prerequisite for the course to be completed. Mm-hmm. That's for sure. But I usually put a requirement of one post to be added or two posts or discussions to be added. So there is some kind of nudge to start from there. And I think that we don't have to force people to participate in the icebreaker. Usually are the most easygoing forums with the most of participation, as long as you have a clever or a funny subject. I often found very attractive forum discussions to be revived, even not as an icebreaker, but as nudge during the participation.
Oh, yes.
And just by posting a nice cake or a coffee that everybody loves. So it was a nice discussion, how you drink your coffee. And it's something, you know, from the everyday. And another great example that I've seen with icebreakers was an idea that teacher was sharing three songs of different types, completely different types. He said, which one would you choose? Now, that was really clever because, you know, the music that you listen to and you enjoy actually reflects something from your own personality. So it was really, really clever to help people meet each other. Now, Alex says that they use icebreakers, but it's not obligatory. John says, I used icebreakers when I work with young people, but not so much with adults, although it would be probably useful. Christina says, I love an icebreaker at the beginning of a course. I ask students, high school and university, to take a picture of their shoes and share a favorite memory that occurred while wearing them. It helps me and their peers get a sense of who they are and help us start building community. That's amazing.
That's very original. Yeah, now I'm trying to think of my shoes and something that happened to me when I was wearing them.
Really clever. Thank you, Christina, for saying it. Brenda says, yes, I've used the what do you see outside your window in an introductory asynchronous forum. For live session, we use waterfall a lot. For example, ask a question, then everyone types the response and presses enter at the same time. A waterfall of responses.
Oh. Okay.
That's nice. Never heard that before. Hyatt says, reacted to, I love a nice breaker with, okay. There is a reaction with clap. I see reactions. Okay. Aaron says, I love the thought of Susan, the memory whilst wearing them. This is a wonderful idea indeed. And okay, I was a little bit confused before with their reactions. I see people is reacting in the forum messages, the chat messages.
Okay.
But we are ready to move on, I think.
Okay. So let's assume that we've broken the ice. We have our participants engaging in the forums and some of them have asked some questions. The next thing to think about is something very close to my heart, actually. And that is the response time. In other words, you as a teacher, you're monitoring your forum and you see that some people have asked questions, perhaps they have a problem. How long before you feel you should reply? How long before you feel you should acknowledge a post in a forum? And the reason I'm asking this is because this is a major fault of my own in many ways, in that on Moodle.org, people do post problems and I'm there all the time and I'll sometimes answer within a few minutes. And although they might be grateful that we have helped them with their problem, in terms of community, building a forum community, I've actually prevented other people from replying who might have known the answer, but perhaps they needed to spend a bit more time phrasing it because English wasn't their first language, or perhaps they just didn't see it because I'm virtually looking at the forums all the time. So is it a good idea to give a prompt response? When do you think might be the optimum time in order for other participants to reply and then for you to reply? Should it be you, the teacher? When I did my master's again, and as part of the forum's code of conduct or whatever, we were informed that our tutor would aim to reply to any forum posts within 24 hours, okay? Which is slightly longer than my within 5 minutes, but is there a good balance in between? So I'd like to ask you, how do you react to that? Maybe your forums are only for participants to reply to. If it's a forum where there are questions, when do you, as the teacher or the course manager, when do you reply? Anna, you do a lot of this. So what's your experiences first?
Well, as you said, usually in corporate environments, the 24 hours is the expected norm, I would say. But it also depends on the course. It depends on the users. Typically, in Moodle, we have this 30 minutes delay for the forum post to be posted. So you cannot really have a very quick response. You cannot stay there and be around waiting for a response to your message or to your question. But it's always good to give some time to other learners contribute, especially if your course is based on collaboration, if the course is based on peer interaction, and if that's your goal, then you have to step back as an educator, I think, and wait. Let's see. Well, Hyatt says that it depends on the importance of questions and the type of forum. Makes sense. Brenda says that I usually set an activity completion condition that after posting, a participant should also reply to at least X other responses. I come in where appropriate and necessary. This really increased interaction, I guess, Brenda. Elizabeth says, Elizabeth reacted. Usman said that in the case of my hybrid course, I have to give all the responses prior to the next face-to-face session.
Ah, yes, yes.
So, yes, I guess everybody is adapting based on the needs of the course and their learners, which is the right thing to do, I guess.
Indeed. Okay. Shall we move on?
Yes, yes.
Now, we were talking about adapting to meet the needs of the learners and how sometimes it's better if you step back, as Anna says, to allow the participants to contribute themselves. And this is something that I want to move on to now in terms of what I would like to call nurturing. And so if you remember the definitions of a forum moderator and a facilitator's role is that of nurturing, encouraging, trying to engage the participants to participate in the forums. So I'd like to look at how you can best do that. Perhaps the way that you use language in whichever language you're using. And then also in terms of motivating them, what we can do with things like ratings and rewards and so on. So I'm going to talk first of all about something which I used a lot as a high school teacher, which is the sandwich method. I know this looks like a burger. It's supposed to be a sandwich, but I'm sure if you've heard of it before, you understand what I'm saying, which is that if you need to give feedback, then and if there is something that's perhaps not right or that is perhaps you're not comfortable with, then it's always a good idea to sandwich your less comfortable thing in between something that's more positive. So you will start with, thank you for that forum contribution. I'm glad you took the time to reply. And then in the middle, you would say, perhaps you might think again about your comment about such and such an issue. And then at the end, you will say, I'm looking forward to seeing your modified contribution or looking forward to seeing more from you. So you're couching, you're sandwiching the thing that needs improving, the slightly negative thing, in between. Now, I believe this is a cultural thing because my understanding is not all cultures think that this is a way to do it and that you should just be direct and say, this isn't any good. You should improve on this rather than this polite sandwich making. But it's one way that some people try to nurture and to engage people in forums. If your forum is one where there are discussions taking place, there are debates, it's always useful, I think, to ask open-ended questions rather than closed questions where it's a yes or a no or a don't know, to kind of phrase them by saying, well, what do you think about? Why do you think that? Or even in a conditional, what would happen if such and such? Or what is your experience of? All of these are forcing the forum participant to actually write or type or speak more than a simple one or two word answer. And you can also use these, of course, if you have issues where a forum discussion gets quite heated and goes off topic. You can politely say, yes, now we've discussed that, so let's go back to our original theme, or so returning to our original theme and gently bringing it back. Now, we will look shortly at other ways of dealing with when people go off topics, but if you can couch your language in a subtle way, that can also help in this nurturing. Now, many people also are encouraged if they get a kind of a reward, perhaps. So what are your thoughts on ratings? So here we have, for example, average of ratings, and it's very easy to set up ratings in forums, but how useful is it, do you think? On Moodle.org, we have a one-word rating, which is useful, which someone can post if they think a forum post is useful. And in actual fact, if you get a certain number of useful posts, you can become what we call a particularly helpful Moodler on Moodle.org and have a badge, which many people are proud to own over the years. Badges also. Would you give a badge just for contributing in a forum, or is that just too small a contribution? I know we on Moodle Academy, we give badges for completing whole courses. Moodle Role Management, one of our recent new intermediate level admin courses, for instance. And although we don't discuss this here, because we do have a course on assessment, looking at forums, you can, in actual fact, you can grade forum posts. You can show the number of words that people have posted, and you can use grading even with rubrics on forums. I wonder if anyone actually does that. How motivating is this? I have never done it because I've always wanted my forums to be an area where people feel comfortable. But it'd be interesting to know now how you go about nurturing, engaging, motivating in your forums.
Well, I think I will start until everybody else puts their thoughts in the chat. On the contrary, May, I have to say that in my case, I almost always rate forum posts. It's a completely different approach. And that's because in corporate environments, forums are an excellent tool for assessment. And if you see the forums from that point of view, they are so powerful because you can rate the post and grade forums normally as any kind of assignment, and at the same time allow participants to interact and learn together. Mm-hmm. So it's not just a communication. It's much more than that. Through this prism, I found amazing the fact that we can easily set up assessment and use specific scales or create our own scales to assess things. And sometimes, you know, assessment can be, and rating can be just a reward. For example, in a primary school environment, when you want kids to start writing thoughts and practice, you can just create a positive scale. It doesn't matter what is. You can use emojis instead of words and create a scales with fun little icons that will be like the stickers often teachers award to the learners. So I'm very, very fond of the ratings and the possibilities that can have. Let's see in the chat. Usman says that, no, that was the previous. Aaron says that we haven't used ratings. However, we have tried highlighted interesting forum responses in a weekly roundups.
That's nice. Yes. Clever.
And Brendan says that ask participants to each take a turn to facilitate a forum. Huge improvement in focus. Also, simple rating of 0, 1, or 2, where 2 would be for a meaningful contribution, 1 for somewhat useful, and 0 for a greeting or affirmation without contributing to the discussion. This would count towards a participation mark. Definitely. Plus 1 for this, Brenda. I can confirm. I have tried and it worked really nice. And just to point, you mentioned already, just to clarify that we have another course in the academy about assessment with forums, mm-hmm. where you can see a lot of ideas, a lot, well, quite several ideas that could be interesting about this specific subject. And I think we are ready to move on.
Okay, thank you. Actually, it might be useful posting the assessment with forums link in the forums course in which this webinar is found so that people can easily get to it, because I think it complements nicely this course. So we are in the middle of our course. We've got people contributing to our forums. We've been trying to nurture them as best we can and encourage them as best we can. But unfortunately, despite our best efforts, we are still encountering some problems. And these problems, it's irrespective of age or maturity, or whether it's an educational establishment or a commercial corporate establishment, sometimes they occur. People might, for example, go off topic. You might start with a nice discussion, but then people go off and talk about different things on tangent. Occasionally, and we've unfortunately had this on Moodle.org, flaming, where people are posting things in the knowledge that they are going to cause controversy. Maybe they just want to be difficult. Sometimes people disagree, and that's fine. But if it degenerates into something more heated, you as the forum moderator and facilitator, you need to deal with that. And then spam. Now, spam, that is probably an issue if your site is open to the world and people create accounts. But again, these are all issues which need to be thought about. On Moodle.org, so we do have some moderator guidelines for the people in each of our communities who look after the forums. We can't facilitate or moderate all of them. So we have particular guidelines in terms of unsolicited advertising, I'm reading from the screenshot here, or spam. On Moodle.org, we have a reporter spam link that people can alert us to. But it's more difficult when you get issues relating to people having a disagreement, for example, that becomes more heated. If it's someone who's brand new, who's very new to the site, it might be that they join deliberately and we might need to politely remove them. Remember that as a moderator, you have the possibility to send a private reply to someone. So you could privately reply saying, perhaps you should tone this down a little bit. You're also able to go in and edit someone's post. So we have done that. Aurélie Soulier, who is community engagement lead, Helen Foster, who has done this role for many years, and myself, we can go in and we can remove unsatisfactory or inappropriate words. Aurélie has also actually met online with some people to try and discuss why there is a problem and gently encourage them to calm down a bit. You could also temporarily suspend someone. But these are all different methods of dealing with it. More difficult than if people go off topic. So if you're gentle, let's go back to the original theme doesn't work. You can, of course, as a moderator, you can split discussions. But I would like to ask you for your thoughts on what approach do you take in your organization? So on Moodle.org, because we want to encourage our community, we take a subtle approach. We try to just get people to understand the errors of their ways rather than just simply banning them for one wrong thing. Or are you in a place where you have to be very tough? So a quick question. Yes, if you prefer a subtle approach the way that we do. No, if it's you are out, right? You are punished or some kind of reprimand. So a yes or no, please. And while you're doing that, I'm going to ask Anna perhaps what Anna's thoughts are on in terms of approaching problems with forums.
Well, in my experience, I never had cases where we had to ban someone from the forum because they were environments where nobody had a reason to react like that. I mean, they weren't open forums for where someone could come in and just start flaming or create noise. They were meaningful and concentrated to some learning. So we never had such cases. I mean, I've never had this problem. But one thing that I'm always suggesting to facilitators or moderators of forums is to do not be afraid of get involved, a split discussion if the topic goes away. Don't hesitate to reply privately to help learners get back on track. Because one funny post could be a very interesting post on a serious discussion or a debate could derail the whole discussion and ruin your course. So in such cases, of course, you need to remain calm and polite, but you shouldn't be tolerant with these little things. You can put them in another place and get back the class into the focus. And I see that, okay, we have an unanimous yes.
Oh, so you're all subtle. That's great. Yes, definitely. I agree. And I agree. I suppose my experience is mainly from Moodle.org, which is open to the world and anyone can make an account. And so there are more possibilities of problems. My other experience is in a high school where we did occasionally get problems. But it was interesting because in one of the forums when I was a teacher in a high school, some students were making inappropriate comments. And one of the students said, "You shouldn't do that because you know the teachers are watching these forums and they will come and find you." So I thought, yes, self-moderation also. They are aware of it. Yeah. Okay, now I think this is all that I wanted to discuss. We've hopefully gone through from deciding to use a forum, choosing it, having our policy and so on, and trying to encourage and then solve problems. Is there anything else in general that any of you would like to comment on before we wrap up or finish this webinar in a few minutes on the hour? Anything else anyone would like to say in particular? And if you do miss something, please do comment in our general discussion forum in this forum course.
Well, it seems okay. Elizabeth said that tips on policy subscription is optional. Usman asks, just take the advantage of teacher fear to deal with the big group. Yes, that's clever. Elizabeth, yes, a subscription is optional. Subscription is forced.
That's a good point. Yeah.
This is, I think, it can be a discussion on its own, especially when you contextualize it on specific courses and learners. It always depends what you want to do. But my comment would be just to explain learners why this is forum has for subscription and why this forum is optional subscription, and explain them how they can unsubscribe. Usually this is something that is often bypassed by teachers, and I can see that a lot of learners get upset with a huge number of emails coming in. Yes. There, and they feel like being spammed from the course.
Okay, well, before we finish, I'm actually would really like just to point out to you a few things about helping us to grow Moodle Academy and get involved in Moodle Academy. One of those is please come into the course facilitating Moodle forums and look at the activities if you haven't already. And also, by all means, go and have a look at and do the assessment with Moodle forums course, which I think Anna has posted the link in there. And if you have any ideas for future webinars, please suggest them in our Get Involved course. We have been running webinars based on people's suggestions. And also, perhaps you have a good idea for something that you have experience in and you'd like to volunteer to contribute to a webinar. We would love you to do that. You will get a presenter's badge and you will help give Anna and me a little bit of a rest while you do the work. Please volunteer. And also, perhaps you enjoy writing courses on a particular aspect of Moodle and teaching, and you're welcome to contribute and sharing in creating a course and get a course builder badge. And in terms of the wider community and promotion, please tell your friends about Moodle Academy, get badges and share them on social media to help us grow. And if you are an experienced Moodle educator, then why not take our quiz to check if you're ready to do the Moodle Educator Certification Program, which is a very, very strong program for experienced educators. And then you could do that and get a certificate definitely to be proud of. So that's all from us. And I'm just going to say thank you from me, Mary Cooch.
Thank you for me, Manakasa. See you around.
Bye-bye.